بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الكريم وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين، أما بعد. So the topic I was given was developing or towards an Islamic or a revival of Islamic scholarship. So I want to begin today just by telling you what I'm not going to do. I'm not going to be listing some steps to revive Islamic scholarship. I'm not going to give you a formula. I'm not going to give you a plan. Because life doesn't work like that. I can't. If anyone could give you a plan, it would certainly not be me. Life is much more complex than coming up with these simplistic plans that we often do. Because we human beings, we're full of hubris. We think we understand a lot, and we love to have solutions, convenient solutions to complex problems. But sometimes it doesn't work like that. We want 7 steps to success. We want 10 steps for this thing, or 5 steps for that thing. And often they fail. So I'm not going to be doing that. But what we are going to do is just, perhaps in the time that we are given, just to look at, you know, some thoughts about what holistic Islamic scholarship is. I'll give you 3 things. We'll share 3 things. Number one, I'll give you 1 thought about what I think holistic Islamic scholarship should be. And secondly, I want to look at perhaps 3 examples or a number of examples of scholars in our tradition who fit that model, who were holistic scholars. And finally, maybe end with looking at these scholars and their circumstances to see what was it, or what were the circumstances, the context that developed those scholars, and perhaps if that can be replicated today. So first of all, you know, the revival of Islamic scholarship, there was a great scholar, Sheikh Abu Hamad al-Ghazali, rahimahullah ta'ala, who spent his entire life, and his magnum opus was entitled Ihya Ulumuddin, the revival of Islamic scholarship. It's multiple volumes. And for many scholars, he got many things right, and for others, he got some things wrong. But if someone of that caliber can spend his life and produce, you know, an exploration of this topic, who am I to give you some thoughts in just 20 minutes or 30 minutes? So really, I think at the end of the day, we human beings, we need to be humble. We need to step back, recognize our shortcomings and limitations, and at the end of the day, do our best. Try to understand what Allah gave us, try to understand guidance. Do our best, and at the end of the day, put our trust in Allah. So firstly, a word about what holistic Islamic scholarship is. Human beings were born with tunnel vision. We have a tendency to focus on one thing. Our eyes are such that we're focusing on an object we don't really see in the periphery. So we have this tendency to just look at our surroundings, or look at immediately what's in front of us, and not really at our surrounding. So we have this capacity for tunnel vision. Allah Azza wa Jalla, He recognized that fact. He created us in this world with instincts. We need to survive, we need to eat, we need to drink. In that immediacy of our environment, we tend to forget the bigger picture. So there's always this need to look at the bigger picture. So Allah steps in and reminds us always to look at the bigger picture. So human beings, we, in this tough life that we live in these circumstances, you saw what's going on in Yemen. You saw what goes on all around us. Everyone goes through circumstances. But sometimes it's hard to look at the bigger picture in the immediacy of that environment. So a lot of people, as the Quran says, وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا يَتَمَتَّعُونَ وَيَأْكُلُونَ كَمَا تَأْكُلُ الْأَنْعَامُ وَالنَّارُ مَثْوًا لَهُمْ. So he says, some people who disbelieve because of that tunnel vision, what do? They enjoy life. They eat and they drink, just like the cattle or the animals, they eat and drink. فَالنَّارُ مَثْوًا لَهُمْ. And the hellfire is their abode. So this danger of tunnel vision is that it can cloud the bigger picture. And you might not even recognize who created you and what the purpose of your life is. So Allah reminds us again and again of the bigger picture. He reminds us of the purpose of our existence. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. He says again and again, and for one particular verse, we have created you, men and jinn, only to worship me. Allah reminded us with 124,000 prophets and messengers. As Ammar mentioned, that we are an ummah for 14 centuries, we haven't had a messenger. But look at the whole context of human history. 124,000 times Allah chose a human being to send a reminder. Reminding us of what? The bigger picture. That life is not just about food and drink and enjoyment, but it's about recognizing our Creator, recognizing where we came from and where we are headed, and worshiping Him, subhanahu wa ta'ala. But even as believers, once we enter into the faith, there's this tendency to just look at a few things, or to pick and choose and be selective in our faith. So Allah Azza wa Jal, He reminds us, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أُدْخُلُوا فِي السِّلْمِ كَافَّةً وَلَا تَتَّبِعُوا خُطُوَاتِ الشَّيْطَانِ. He says, O you who believe, enter into this faith, submit to this faith, all of it, kafatan, and do not follow the footsteps of shaitan. Because sometimes human beings, we pick and choose, or we're involved in something and we forget other things. That's the nature of human beings. So even in our faith, when we enter into faith, Allah reminds them, this is a verse perhaps that has the greatest bearing on our topic, holistic Islamic scholarship. O believers, enter into Islam wholeheartedly. Our Mufassireen, they talked about this verse and they said there are several opinions, but there are two major opinions. They said it means, one group said it means udkhulu fis silmi kafatan, means all of you enter into the faith. Yani all human beings, all the groups need to enter into the faith. But the second interpretation, and that's interpretation favored by Ibn Kathir and others, is that it means enter into all of your faith. All of Islam, all the rulings, you don't have the right to pick and choose. The guidance, Allah gave you a system of life. Enter into it entirely. Kafatan. And this is very, very important because Muslims, we have this, or human beings, and even Muslims, we have this capacity to pick and choose. That's why the companions, radiallahu anhum, they recognize this. And they interpreted these verses and they gave people ways to navigate the application of these verses. Hudhayfa ibn al-Yaman, radiallahu an, he said, for instance, in the tafsir of this verse, he said, al-Islamu thamaniyatu ashum. He said, in the terminology that people could understand, look, Islam is like eight arrows. There are eight arrows in Islam. This is your faith. It composes of eight parts. So he says, salatu sahmun, wa zakatu sahmun, وَالْحَجُّ سَهْمٌ وَالصَّوْمُ سَهْمٌ وَالْعُمْرَةُ سَهْمٌ. He says, Salah is an arrow. He says, Zakah is an arrow. He said, Hajj is an arrow. Fasting is an arrow. He said, Al-Jihadu Sahmun. He said, وَالْعُمْرَةُ سَهْمٌ. Umrah is an arrow, is a component of your faith. And then at the end, he said, the last two, وَالْأَمْرُ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَالنَّهْيُ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ سَهْمٌ. Enjoining the good, as Ammar talked about, and forbidding people from evil is also an arrow. So accept all of these arrows. He said, وَقَدْ خَابَ مَنْ لَا سَحْمَ لَهُ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ. The one who doesn't have any of these portions of his deen, then he is defective, then he is destroyed. قَدْ خَابَ. So this is very important advice. And Allah recognizes our shortcomings. He gives us this advice. Look, enter into Islam entirely, because get out of this tunnel vision. Look at the bigger picture. So with that, we all know people, we know the problems that come from not looking at the bigger picture. Even in Islamic scholarship, sometimes we have scholars that focus on one aspect of the deen to the neglect or the detriment of another aspect of the deen. How many works of tafsir, for instance, are marred by their scholars or the authors not being proficient in hadith? So there's amazing works of Quran or tafsir, but because of their lacking in understanding the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wasallam, there's a huge component missing. And that is, Allah sent the messenger along with the Quran to teach us. If you eliminate the messenger from this, how can you get a complete picture of the guidance? And how many others, perhaps, who focus on hadith, and they never quote Quran, they never refer to the timeless guidance of the Quran. That's also a defect, an aib. So we need, in scholarship, we need to look at all the aspects of Islam. How many people delve into jurisprudence, to the details of fiqh, and they forget the higher purposes of the sharia? They forget the highest directives of the Quran. And it's all these peripherals and not the essentials. So this is very, very important. Not only in scholarship, we all know human beings. Everyone knows that person that has one issue that they devote their life to. America is full of that, of people who are single issue people. So people vote based on single issues. You always have that one person, he devotes his life to one cause, and that's all he's about. There are so many people like that in our community, but when you look at those people, when you're so focused on one cause, you forget other things. So today, I was giving the khutbah in a masjid a couple of hours ago, and I gave a khutbah being that it was Black Friday. I talked about Islamic principles of wealth, or how Islam views the idea of wealth. But after the khutbah, there was an individual from the audience, he was very angry, he came to me, and he said, "Why didn't you talk about the Saudis?" I was like, "What?" I was a little taken aback. I was like, "I'm talking about wealth management. That's not my topic, brother. Why do you never talk about the Saudis?" I was like, "That's not my topic, brother. Do you know me? You don't know anything about me." But he just kept going on, and then he just left. So there are people like that. They can only focus on one thing. When you do that, you can't see anything else. That's the problem with tunnel vision. Has the capacity to destroy. So that's the first thought, the idea of looking at the bigger picture. Now the second portion, who are some examples of scholars that were looking at the bigger picture, who are great examples of holistic Islamic scholarship? There are so many in our tradition, mashallah, but I'm going to mention just three from one particular time period. Our first scholar, and I'm not going to do a biography, just mention their name, just a few points about them, and it's up to you to research them further. Our first scholar was someone from North Africa. He was a historian. He was born or he died around the turn of the 15th century, so the beginning of the 1400s. This is Christian era. He was someone who was so brilliant. I remember when I was in college, I took a course on colonialism. It was an amazing course, one of the seminal courses for me. I remember what the professor, he was non-Muslim, he was from Cuba. He told us something that never left my mind. He said about this particular scholar that this was a man who was the most brilliant scholar that ever lived, past, present, or future. And I was very struck by what he said. This is a non-Muslim saying this about a Muslim scholar. And of course, he was talking about none other than Ibn Khaldun, the historian, rahimahullah ta'ala. I had heard about him, I never really read him in detail, I've read some things about him, but over the years I began studying Ibn Khaldun and referring to him and looking at his and studying him in the various programs I attended, and I realized what he was saying was only what other scholars were saying, like the British historian Arnold Toynbee. He said about Ibn Khaldun's work, Ibn Khaldun wrote a work called the Muqaddima, an amazing, brilliant work, which is an introduction to world history. The Muqaddimah. So Toynbee, he said about that, this work is undoubtedly the greatest work of its kind that has ever yet been created by any mind in any time or place. So just imagine when people are saying these kind of things about, you know, works like these or scholars in our tradition, they require further investigation. They deserve our attention. And when you look at Ibn Khaldun, really, he was someone who was brilliant. He was someone who, you know, people think he was a secular writer. There's a misconception that he was someone who wasn't in Islamic sciences, but he was a secular writer. But that's not true. He was well-versed in Quran. He was well-versed in hadith to the point even when he quotes hadith, he is a bona fide hadith scholar. But his work was history. So he wanted to bring history together. And when he analyzed history, he wanted to look at the bigger picture. He was always looking for patterns in history. And he wrote such brilliant works. And he compiled an exhaustive volumes on history, where what he wanted to do was give you history with patterns, with his critical insights, with his theories. And he laid down the foundations for so many sciences. Imagine this. Ibn Khaldun is the one who has the credit for laying down in his works the foundations for political science, sociology, anthropology, and economics, and so many of the philosophy of history. All of these sciences, their foundation was laid down in his Muqaddimah and in his other works. And this is hundreds of years before Europe began writing about history. So this is a brilliant scholar that we were blessed with, someone who was always looking at, you know, the bigger picture. And he, in his beginning, in the beginning of the Muqaddimah, he begins with a point. Just to give you an idea about what he's talking about, he begins with one point. And I was in Virginia 2 weeks ago in the Fairfax Institute and attending a course on Muslim history. And the teacher, he began the entire course, 3-day course, with one point. And people don't realize that point was taken from the Muqaddimah. That's the first point of Ibn Khaldun. He draws a distinction between facts and truth. And he says, human beings, we don't need facts. We need truth as moral human beings. And what is he talking about? He's saying too many, and Ibn Khaldun complains about, he says, too much history is written just a series of dates and facts. What are human beings to do with that? Well, what the task of historians is to construct a narrative, derive truth and meanings from those facts. And that's precisely what he does in his Muqaddimah and in all his works. He develops these theories of history, he analyzes why nations rise and fall. So today, all of us could use, the Muslim world could use a little more of Ibn Khaldun, rahimahullah ta'ala. 20 years prior to him, and our time is winding down, only 20 years prior to Ibn Khaldun, there was another great scholar who lived in Andalus. His name was Abu Ishaq al-Shatibi. He was a great scholar, a brilliant scholar. So in his time, he noticed that people were involved in such peripheral matters of jurisprudence. And it was a very challenging time politically as well. So he saw people leaving the faith, people questioning Islam, and the scholars were involved in petty things. So he felt something was missing from the Muslim community and the Muslim discourse. So he began studying and analyzing. He said in his own work, Al-I'tisam, he said, I delved into every Islamic science I came across. I studied all of them. I didn't leave any one of them out. And I looked at the peripheral sciences and the central sciences, the foundational sciences. And he said, I began to draw patterns. I was always looking at the bigger picture. And then he compiled an amazing work on legal theory, Al-Muwafaqat. This is a work for the first time he was analyzing all the commands and rules in Islam, trying to understand the wisdom or the maqsad, the purpose behind every command. And today his thought has been resurrected. There are a lot of people talking about maqasid. You might have heard maqasid al-sharia, the objectives of the sharia. Our Abu Ishaq al-Shatibi was the one who first talked about that. So he analyzed the sharia and he developed this amazing work where he analyzed what are all these rules in Islam, what are they under? So he analyzed, for instance, he said, you know, all of this salah, reading Quran, it's under the broad purpose of dhikr, of remembering Allah. And the ultimate purpose of everything is the test, the divine test that Allah created human beings with. And then he even analyzed human transactions, all of the human transactions, the laws of marriage and divorce, for instance, and the laws of buying and selling, they fall under taqwa, developing this awareness of Allah in human life. So he places them under the purpose of taqwa, this maqsad, or the broad aim of taqwa. When I was studying al-muwafaqat many years ago with one of my teachers, I remember, and I'll just share with you one point, he mentioned how this can help us today. He was talking about the blasphemy issue. And I know that's a great or hot topic issue today. But many years ago, I remember this point. He said that when you find in the Muslim world, some people, you know, they take the law into their own hands and they murder somebody who supposedly insulted the Quran or insulted the Prophet. What are they really doing? If you analyze the way Imam al-Shatibi was looking at the Sharia, yes, you know, preserving the sanctity of the Quran is a purpose of Sharia. It's one of the goals. It's under taqwa. But then preserving the sanctity of life is a higher ideal. It's also under taqwa. So what these people, they're sacrificing a major taqwa for a minor taqwa, a major command for a minor command. So this is how you can see in our real world, Imam al-Shatibi's thought can help you prioritize, help you make sense of the world that we live in and make sense of the Sharia. So we could use a lot more Imam al-Shatibi today, rahimahullah ta'ala. Now when Imam al-Shatibi was born, that leads us to our third scholar. When he was born, another scholar had died, and that was our third scholar. And when it comes to holistic scholarship, when it comes to looking at the bigger picture, when it comes to having a grasp of all of the Islamic sciences, perhaps in our entire tradition, there is no scholar greater or more worthy of that than this particular scholar, and he was Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullahu ta'ala. His life, wallahi, is a life that you need to study. What he wrote, the volumes that he wrote, are so relevant to us today that we're still beginning to pick up the pieces and understand what he wrote. We still don't understand the true depth and the breadth of what Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah wrote about. There is no topic in our tradition, from fiqh to tafsir to usul al-fiqh to hadith, even topics that weren't invented at or fields that weren't invented at that time, that don't enjoy the prolific pen of Ibn Taymiyyah, that aren't blessed by his what he wrote about that. He had that uncanny ability to cut to the heart of every issue. There are so many people who read his works. Unfortunately, he's still misunderstood today, perhaps by people who claim to be his followers and perhaps by many of his enemies. So people don't really read him. But when people objectively read Ibn Taymiyyah, he's transformative. There are so many people you can point to today. You know, I'll give you just a few examples. Wa'il Halaq, he read his work, Ar-Raddu ala al-Mantaqiyin. He wrote an amazing work. He wrote so many foundational, groundbreaking works in different topics. One of them was refuting Greek logic. So he wrote a work, and you know, it's interesting, how did he write it? A student came to him, and he was asking questions about philosophy and history. And Ibn Taymiyyah realized there was some problem the way he was thinking. So between Dhuhr and Asr prayer, he sat down and began writing some thoughts. And he wrote this work, Ar-Raddu ala al-Mantaqiyin, between Dhuhr and Asr. He didn't finish it all in one day, but he took a few more days, but between these two prayers, he wrote this work. This work is so voluminous, it's so complex, that it's being translated today. And Wa'il Halaq, who's a professor in Columbia University, translated it, and he was struck by it. And he said about this work that this was the first and the last time Muslims criticized Greek logic. Yani, this was a death blow to Greek logic. Now, Shaykh al-Islam Ibn Taymiyyah wasn't against logic or rationality, but what he was criticizing was a particular type of logic, Greek logic, that formed the basis of so many sciences and caused so much misunderstanding in society. And one of my teachers said, what Ibn Taymiyyah wrote in that treatise thousands of years ago or hundreds of years ago, there are modern philosophers who are discovering that today and echoing the same thoughts. Wa'il Halaq writes, for instance, the reader of Ibn Taymiyyah's works cannot but be struck by his extraordinary ability to define and isolate the crucial and fundamental principles upon which the most complex system of thought are erected. So this is the kind of impression or the kind of influence he had by anyone who reads him with an open mind. There was a great scholar in India, Allama Shibli Nu'mani. So he was in India, Ibn Taymiyyah was never popular. So people never really read him. So towards the end of his life, he read this Ar-Radd. And he said he was blown away by that. And he wrote an article about this. And he said for the first time, he began to see some issues of logic that he never understood before. And he said if Allah gave him life, he would write a biography on Ibn Taymiyyah. And if Shibli Nu'mani was a writer of Seerah, he's a writer of biography, he was a historian. He's a great scholar from the past century. But he died before completing that work. But the seeds he planted were felt in India. So this is, you know, anyone who reads Ibn Taymiyyah, this is what they come across. There's another great professor, Yahya Mishaw, is an interesting character. And I have about 10 minutes, so I'll share with you some of these tidbits. I'm not giving you a biography of these scholars. There's certainly, we cannot accomplish that in the short time that we have. But Yahya Mishaw was a European researcher, brilliant guy, someone who speaks 11 languages. So he embraced Islam in the course of his journeys, and then he fell in love with Ibn Sina. Ibn Sina was another great scholar of our tradition. So he spent his life studying Ibn Sina to the extent that he became the foremost Western expert on Ibn Sina. He published on him, he did his PhD and his dissertations. And then he said one day he discovered another work of Ibn Taymiyyah called Daru Ta'arud Bayn al-Aqli wa al-Naql. This is reconciling revelation and reason. This is a huge work. And he said when he read that work, there were so many questions that arose in his mind when he was reading Ibn Sina, and they were answered in Ibn Taymiyyah's work. So his whole passion shifted from Ibn Sina to Ibn Taymiyyah. Then he began studying Ibn Taymiyyah. And then to this day, he refers to Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah as his Shaykh, as one who opened his eyes. He's written a number of books on him. So this is the kind of effect that he had on brilliant thinkers. You know, he's someone who's underappreciated. He wrote on so many topics. He wrote on tafsir. Even in hadith, Imam al-Dhahabi said his works are tasanif bahira. He described all of his books as books or works that are so overpowering, they overpower everything else. So he was someone who had a grasp of Quran. He would read hundreds of tafsir to answer a question. He had a full grasp of hadith. And this is very rare to find a well-rounded scholar that has such a command of hadith. Dhahabi says he was the last person who was quoting the 6 books of hadith and the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, the great works of hadith, from memory without making any mistakes. So there are very rare mistakes of hadith in Ibn Taymiyyah. One of my teachers said you can count maybe 2 or 3 mistakes he made in hadith. Any other scholar, even Ibn Khaldun, when they quote hadith, it's not that exact because they're not muhaddithin. But Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah, Allah blessed him with a mind who was looking at the bigger picture always. He was able to combine all the different aspects of our deen, all the ulum together in such a marvelous way. The Muslim world could use a little more of Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah ta'ala. Finally, the last point, in my last 8 minutes that we have. These were 3 great scholars. They lived not in the same period, but in the same century. They were roughly contemporaries. So the question, the question comes, such brilliant scholars that lived kind of together, they really didn't know each other, they lived independently. What were the ingredients that brought about this holistic scholarship? You would imagine, okay, they probably were great institutions they came from. Or maybe the Muslim world was at a height at this time, there was a golden age. Everyone was memorizing Quran, memorizing Hadith. Maybe there was an environment of knowledge. Maybe you might be thinking of Qurtuba, where there are, street lights 1,000 years ago, where 1,000 universities in one city. But the truth is, if you look at Ibn Taymiyyah, he was born in 1263. If you minus 5 years, 5 years before 1263, there's one date that's etched in the Muslim soul forever, 1258. Who knows what happened in 1258? Anyone? Just blurred it. I can't really see you. The light. Baghdad. 1258 was the sacking of Baghdad by the Mongols. So the Mongols, they devastated the Muslim world. This is something unprecedented in human history. This was a force that came from the east. They changed the carbon footprint of the planet. And they came and they destroyed the Muslim world. In 1258, they reached Baghdad, which was the capital, the Abbasid Caliphate, and they rained havoc and destruction. They killed all the people, millions of people were slaughtered, and they destroyed all of the books that we had in our tradition. Muslim world never recovered from that. That was the most devastating attack on the Muslim world, and historians say this was the end of the Islamic golden period. So this is the time period that we're talking about. 5 years later, Ibn Taymiyyah is born. So it comes back to that point, we all want formulas, we want ingredients. What is it? We all talk about maybe it's institutions, we need institutions to produce individuals like that. But these 3 individuals came from some of our darkest times. So really, it's quite the opposite. So really what it is, what we need to do is we need to think tajdeed or revival is not engineered. It doesn't come through formulas, but it comes out of hard circumstances. So at the end of the day, what do we need? We need to look at the bigger picture. We need to trust in Allah. We need to do our part, but put our trust and faith in Allah. Don't worry about the details so much. Don't worry about institutions so much. That's not really the answer. The answer will never come in a series of formulas. But at the end of the day, put your trust in Allah. Remain optimistic. If these were the dark times that produced these 3 great scholars, our times certainly aren't darker than that. So be hopeful, be optimistic. Allah promised us his deen will continue. In every generation he will raise people. We just have to do our part. We have to do our part and we put our trust in Allah. And trusting in Allah, I'll end with that, is tawakkul. What is tawakkul? Tawakkul is the highest level of faith. You believe in Allah and through your faith, you increase your certainty until you reach this level. Tawakkul is where you're confident, you do what you do, you adopt your means, but that at the end of the day, you put the trust in Allah and you leave it in the hands of Allah. That's the kind of attitude we need. Try your best, but know that the details are up to Allah. Allah says in the Quran, وَمَنْ يَتَوَكَّلَ عَلَى اللَّهِ فَهُوَ حَسْبُهُ. Whoever puts his trust in Allah, Allah is sufficient for them. Tawakkul is, you do what you can, and Allah will take over and do what you can. وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَى خَيْرِ خَلْقِهِ مُحَمَّدٍ وَعَلَى آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ وَسَلَّمَ.